woman I wake up before I put on my makeup. I say a little prayer for you. And while I'm combing my hair now and wondering what dress to wear now, I say a little prayer for you.
Jesus' name, I lift you up and eternal. your
feet back
on higher ground. Sick.
Hey, testing.
Heal the leg. And it says you can heal them too in Jesus' name.
In that number,
when the saints go marching in.
If you would all like to stand just as a show of support for the family, please do so.
How sweet it is to be loved by you. How sweet it is to be loved by you.
please take your seats. Welcome, everyone, to this Thanksgiving service for the life of Molly Simons. My name is Chris Thornton. I'm the pastor here at Ford's Lane Church, and it's my pleasure to welcome you and the family here today. And you may come with all kinds of mixed emotions. There may be grief, but also joy. And we're here not just to grieve, but to celebrate a remarkable life of someone who lived a life well-lived. A woman who loved her family, a woman who loved people, a woman who loved her Lord, a woman who loved life. And I only met her once towards the end of her life in a care home, but I could see the mischievous twinkle in her eye. And I know many of you today will have memories, and we're going to share some of those today, because Molly was a gift of God's goodness to us. And that's why this is a Thanksgiving service to celebrate her life. And the Bible says that we don't grieve as those who have no hope. Because for Christians, we believe that Jesus, when he said, "I am the resurrection and the life, those who believe in me, even though they die, will live." At the center of the Christian faith is the message that because Jesus' life and death and resurrection, because of his love for us, he came so that we, though we experience death, can also experience a life beyond the grave too. That there is a hope in this life. And everyone who trusts in him, and Molly did, Molly put her faith in Jesus. And for her and for Christians, we believe Molly isn't just gone and we have a memory of her today. Neither is she just in some better place, but we don't know where that is. Actually, the Christian hope is that she is home. She is home, ready to enjoy fullness of life in a relationship with a God who has loved her to the skies, and she is truly at rest right now. And it is that hope that we're going to sing about, and we're going to stand and sing, and then afterwards Winifred is going to come and read a passage from John. But I'd love us to stay seated for the first verse of How Great Thou Art, which Geraldine is going to sing to us. And then afterwards I'd love us all to stand and join in. There should be some words on the screen or in your order of service. So Geraldine will sing the first verse, and then afterwards let's stand to sing together How Great Thou Art.
Awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hand has made. I see the stars, I hear the awesome thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Saviour
everybody. The Bible reading today is from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Jesus said to his friends, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I would go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Now, Ashley and Bill are going to come and say something.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining the family to celebrate Molly's expansive and joyful life. I'm Ashley Simons, Molly's nephew. Molly always affectionately called me her favorite nephew. I'm not sure that was true, as I had brothers and a sister, but it made me feel good. Molly was more like a second mother rather than an aunt. Molly was born 16th of January 1929 in Kamata, a rural suburb of Calcutta. Her parents were Frederick and Dorothy Moore, and she was the youngest of six children. They experienced difficult and challenging times growing up in a rural environment, made much harder when the sad loss of an immediate member of the family. Molly and her siblings were brought up by her uncle Cecil, who dedicated his life looking after them. It's through these times and life's experiences that Molly cemented her unshaken bond for kinship and a legacy for the love and caring of family. Auntie Molly took great pride in telling us she was Miss Asansol in her teens and also trained as a nurse where she first met her husband Keith, a patient in the hospital she was nursing in. Their marriage lasted a magnificent 47 years, with the passing of Keith in 1998. They had a loving and productive family of five children, Stephen, Pam, Susan, Peter, and Trish, plus a legacy of 10 grandchildren and six great-great-grandchildren, and onwards with future generations. The Simons family, amongst many other families, lived through and experienced a huge upheaval of India's independence and partition in August 1947. This major event resulted in some very difficult and pressing times for the Anglo-Indian community. The Simons family, along with many other Anglo-Indians, left India. This exodus created a widespread Anglo-Indian diaspora in the UK, Canada, Australia, and other parts of the Commonwealth. Keith and Molly and Stephen left India in the summer of 1954, flying with Pan Am to the UK, where family life was not easy. They endured and flourished despite all the uncertainties and challenges they faced in their new homeland during the 50s and 60s. They arrived with little wealth and the family grew to great achievements. Molly never lost her love for homeland, especially the love for Indian sweets and the talent of cooking the tastiest chicken curry and dal and rice you'd have ever eaten. And we had lots of it in 12 Ashley Drive. Molly had an infectious joie de vivre and loved being the centre of the party, and a lovely sense of humour, and was always glamorous in her appearance. Family life grew, got better, and good times followed. Molly and her sister-in-law, my mother, Evelyn, danced the nights away at Hammersmith Palais, and above all, supported each other and their families throughout their lives. And this support resolutely continues through their families to this day. Now is the time to hand over to Bill to reflect on Molly's enriched life in the UK.
Thank you, Ashley, and thank you everyone for coming. First of all, apologies because I've delivered a eulogy about an hour ago, so some of you will already know what I'm going to say, but many of you won't. And Ashley has supported me with some similar comments to the ones I made. It won't matter because I know Molly never bothered about me telling the same jokes every year or the same magic tricks, so she was happy with that. I'm concentrating on two things with Molly. I think the first thing I would say is that she is a matriarch. And I did some digging in a dictionary, and it described a matriarch as a woman who has earned respect and gained the wisdom to enrich a family or group. And that is certainly true of the influence that Molly had on people, not only in her family, but I dare say she was a matriarch in this church as well, a place she loved. The key word there is enrich. The second word I used to describe Molly is amazing, because she was. She was an amazing woman, an amazing mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother, an amazing Christian, an amazing fashionista, amazingly glamorous, amazingly funny, amazingly fearless, forgiving, loving, generous, and had brought up an amazing family. 5 years ago, Molly was given days to live. It's no surprise that she continued to fight to live an extra 5 years. Maybe not as healthy or as mobile as she was, but always there to help and inspire her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, cousins, nephews, nieces, and friends. She was always an absolute influence to everybody. Ashley has told us about the amazing life she led from coming from India to the UK, so I won't dwell on that. Despite all that, all that life threw at her, Molly demonstrated her amazing faith. Christian, yes, but the principles she lived by are a lesson and example to us all. Her ability to deal with misfortune and to continue the business of life without complaint are a continuing inspiration. Now, the world has changed dramatically during Molly's life. I'm sure that the challenge of those five highly spirited children helped her embrace the changes to society that she's witnessed in her 95 years. And it's a shame to think that people like Molly may become rarer. Someone who never complained about their lot and didn't blame others. Someone who had love for everyone. Someone who only saw the good in people. And someone who lived their life through high principles. In modern parlance, Molly owned the room. She was always the focal point of attention. And it was no wonder Keith retired to his study whenever Molly was in full flow. She was inspirational and motivational without even trying. She was funny without telling jokes. And we laughed with her, not at her. Although there was one moment, which was probably one of the funniest moments of my life, when Molly broke her personal record for the 25-meter sprint at the age of 65, when we were on holiday in La Manga, and we were going down a very steep pavement, and Molly's walking stick disappeared, and so did Molly, down the hill, and she couldn't stop running and screaming. And we're just thinking, there's no way she's going to stop, and there's no way we're going to catch her. So we says, Pam and the girl, she said, grab the lamppost, grab the lamppost, which Molly did and hung on. Over time, I've seen her swinging around that lamppost, but it was probably just the once, and she stopped and we saved her. And she was terrified. It was a terrifying moment, but we were killing ourselves laughing. It was so funny. And Molly saw the joke after that. It was a lovely moment. She also loved music, and I share a great love of music, as some of you will know. She loved boogie-woogie, she loved gospel, she loved reggae, all sorts. And I used to love it when she was round at our house where we have a nice jukebox and we'd play all these various songs, and she would pick up on a song and say, I like that, maybe an artist she didn't know. So it was good. And I got on very well with her on that basis. But I actually had to... I've done some playlists for the entertainers afterwards of music that Molly loved and liked, and so I've been doing all this kind of thing. Now, the only problem is that she liked Cliff Richard. And I can't get out of my head blooming Cliff Richard songs now. They've been there for about 5 days now. Power to all our friends. I don't know. So Molly did give us lessons in how to run our lives. She was selfless with family at the core, and I do hope that her grandchildren and great-grandchildren will always remember that. She was always positive. She overcame and conquered adversity without recrimination, and she took everyone at face value. She was devoted to her family, and I'm proud to be considered part of that family. And as you said, Ashley, I didn't regard her as my mother-in-law because she treated me like her son, not son-in-law, and that was a relationship. Above all, she fought for everything and everybody and never blamed others for the things and loved ones that she'd lost in her life. She had an amazing life, she was an amazing woman, and she was an amazing matriarch. She often said recently that she was ready to meet her maker, and if she is, she's now with Jesus, probably sharing a curry she's just cooked, and listening to Cliff, I would think. At the same time, she would be looking down on all her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. And believe me, she will be continuing to influence all our lives for all our lives. So may she rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ashley and Bill. Let us respond to that. How do you follow that? Let us respond to that by actually singing another hymn that Molly loved, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, which is a good way to respond to what you've just said. Let's stand and sing. Thank you. please grab a seat. And we're now going to hear from Pam and Trish, and then afterwards Susan will give a poem. Or is poem?
Change me around.
Okay, feel free to come up and do your poem, then afterwards be Pam and Trish.
Hello, everybody. I'm Susan, Molly's middle daughter, for those that don't know me. And I wrote a little poem for her. I first wrote a version of this poem for her on her 90th birthday. We had a lovely celebration for her. But I thought I would sort of do a slightly different version of it. It's with the same name. And I was inspired mainly by nature and the season that we're in. And also our relationship with nature and the universe. That I think we often feel that when we have these times like this, what's it all about? Where do we come from? Where do we go? So I'll just find it for you. And that, Diana, if you're there, I'm sorry I didn't pick up the notes. So, the name of the poem is O Mother of Mine. And as it rains today, as it has done, the sun shines tomorrow. O Mother of Mine, who shines so bright and left a smile with all, amongst the majestic magnolia and blossom bud, precious tears of love fall. A red rose of love, seeds embedded within our hearts. Birds sing and rivers flow. While a host of golden daffodils stand straight and tall, saluting a golden guard of honour, bluebells shout below. And flowers rejoice at such a gem to join them in their grace, Mother Earth. Mother Moon stills the waves, and so the silver light fades. Amid a crown of stars, she lays on the wings of angels as they arrive to escort her preciously home. O Mother of Mine, take our love. O Mother of Mine, we wave goodbye. Thank you.
Mum, my gorgeous, beautiful, wonderful mum. Mum's heart was like her front door. It was never locked. She invited everyone in, and believe me, they all came. When Mum and Dad arrived in England, no family had arrived here yet, and life was very hard for them. When I was born, we came home on the bus to the room they'd rented for the four of us. What a contrast to the very privileged life they had in India, with cooks, drivers, nannies, and lots of help on hand. But London life was very cold and very different, and it took some getting used to. Having four children very quickly, they struggled. The Salvation Army and the local Jewish community in Islington were a great help to us. Mum worked at Peter Jones on Oxford Street on Foyle's Bookshop full-time whilst bringing us four children up. Then times got even worse, and our family was split up for 6 months, until we were reunited again in our new home in Gypsy Hill during the very cold winter of 1962-3. Very soon after this, life became a bit easier when Dad's job moved us out to Bletchley. However, Mum became seriously ill while she was pregnant with Trish, and afterwards we had to have a home help for over a year while she recovered. Now we are a family of seven. We had a three-bedroom house, Mum, Dad, five children, and my Uncle Fred living with us. And Mum's mum, our Nana, became a regular visitor from India, staying for 6 months at a time. Despite that, I don't remember the house being cramped. It was just normal. Mum worked at a children's home near to where we lived, so the children came to our home a lot, and we often played with them at their home. Later on, Mum worked in an old people's home. They too became regular visitors. Mr. Smart in his wheelchair, and Lenny, who had special needs. The house was always full, and we had lots of fun. We moved again to a four-bedroom house in Bletchley. Mum had several more jobs after that. Barclays Bank, the tax office, Bletchley Park. My parents didn't drive. We walked everywhere. But Mum decided we were having a car, and they would learn to drive. She bought a car which sat outside the house. We used to pretend to use the car and have picnics in it. Dad had lessons but never took to driving. Maybe his memories of being driven in India were too scary. For those who have experienced India will understand this. So the car was sold. In 1972, Dad's job moved us up north, and Mum and Dad bought their first house in Bramhall. A four-bedroom, two-bathroom, brand-new, four-storey townhouse, just absolutely perfect for us all. We were the bee's knees. How far Mum and Dad had brought us from our early days in London. Mum worked at the Ministry of Defence, the Pine Shop, Hillbrook Grange and Debenhams. Later on, working in Peter's carpet shop, mainly, I think, so he could get on the golf course. Obviously, Mum knew nothing about carpets, but she welcomed them into the shop and they all came back the next day to see Peter to purchase a carpet. We have very happy memories from our house in Newquay Drive. Four of the five children got married from that house. Grandchildren appeared. There was always a wonderful welcome. The never-ending curry pot on a Sunday with no set time, you could just turn up and you would be fed. Maybe that's why my nickname is Sil, sorry I'm late. Mum loved people, loved party, loved entertaining. Leading the conga onto the street on New Year's Eve or round a restaurant at 3 p.m. in the afternoon, like at Georgie's graduation meal. A real party person. She gave us very many happy days with an awful lot of love. Thank you, Mum.
Didn't they do well? Welcome, everybody, and it's so nice to see so many familiar faces. Isn't it wonderful that Mum was 95 and she could still pack in a crowd like this? It was also a miracle that she lived 95 years. As she told me, she was dying from the age of 8 years of age. So, you know, only Molly could pull that one off. You'll have to bear with me, because I'm usually presenting fashion shows and not doing a speech at a funeral. So if I go wobbly, just bear with me. My earliest memory with Mum was coming home after school. Mum would be playing the piano, and I would sing at the side of her Edelweiss. The other one would be bringing me to the church, this church. I was 7 years old, and I joined JUCO's just opposite here on a Thursday night. And every Sunday we would walk hand in hand and sing all the way home. And we would sing He's Got the Whole World in His Hands. And between the two of us, we'd have to think of every single family member that held in his hands. One of these simple, happy, innocent memories as a child was going to the Wimpy. The grandkids and the grandchildren will not know what the Wimpy is, but the Wimpy was the equivalent of a McDonald's. It was the first sort of fast food place that you'd go. And we'd have a milkshake and having a burger using those plastic tomato sauce things. I don't know if you remember those, but I was besotted with these. So she bought me one so we could go home and pretend to be at the Wimpy together. When things were difficult with Mum and Dad and struggling, I then moved to Canada. And at the age of three, I lived there with my Nana and my uncle for 3 years. So my childhood was very different from my siblings. When I came home, Mum was waiting, open arms, and I never left her side again. All through our lives, Mum dedicated herself to her children. When Stephen was seriously ill, she didn't judge. She just provided a safe place of love. Mum was full of fun, laughter, and she had such a positive attitude. and it was impossible not to love and admire that everything she did in life and that she faced in life. Mum and Dad lived in Ashley Drive, and even though we had all gone and left homes and created our own lives ourselves, we all came back constantly. I think they liked it. We all came back with partners, children, and pets, and friends. Mum and Dad were complete opposites. One an extrovert, one an introvert. Dad loving watching Panorama and Newsnight. Mum loving Coronation Street and Crossroads. One was strict, the other one was a complete pushover. I remember one occasion, Peter had said he wasn't feeling very well that week, and he managed to get a week off school because he had an ache in his little toe. But they loved, Mum and Dad, they loved music, and they loved dancing together. And they only wanted the best for all of us, and they didn't want us to struggle as they had. They were a good team together. As Pam said, Mum's front door was always open. I mean, I don't mean physically open, but she never locked the door. And you never knew when you went into that lounge who was going to be in there. Once I came back, and there were the Hare Krishnas there, all drinking Yorkshire tea with French fancies, Mum's favourite cake. They became regular visitors once a month. Mum even took in teaching, we also then had the Hare Krishnas, who did we have? Sorry, I've lost my place here. We had the Hare Krishnas, well, that was enough to throw you on a speech anyway, wasn't it? We then had the Jehovah's Witnesses. They came and joined in, and she made friends with all of them. She embraced all different types of religion. She didn't judge any of that. She loved people, and she embraced all of that. With the Hare Krishnas, we have some very funny stories, but his grandchildren might remember, they were very young at the time, but she used to teach them the Hare Krishna song and the red flag flying, if I remember. And she used to encourage them to get all the pots and pans out of the cupboard and get the wooden spoons, and they would be marching up and down singing Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. That was our mum with her grandchildren. She loved fashion, as you know, and she took it very seriously, as you should. She was a natural beauty with a wonderful style. I remember on one occasion, she decided actually to get baptised on this actual stage here. I think Mum was about, 72, 73, something around that age. Anyway, the story goes, and I remember this so funnily, but there was a lady that went up before Mum, and she got submerged in here in the stage. And she went off through this door, and she grabbed a towel, she quickly changed within 2 minutes, and she came and sat down here in the congregation. It was then Molly's turn. After being submerged in the water, Mum went through that door and reappeared 30 minutes later. In between this time, the church service resumed with a packed church. Mum not worried about the noise, because she decided to give herself a nice blow dry in the back and do her hair. And all we could hear was a hairdryer. She decided to come through this door here. She had a white pleated skirt, the yellow and white striped jacket, the gold loafers, complete new outfit, full makeup on. She looked $1 million. And she walked out here like a beauty queen, oblivious to all the mayhem that she'd caused in the church. If I had to describe our mum, it would be a woman of substance. She was absolutely a fantastic role model, an independent woman. She contributed to the family income, working so hard all her life. She had an attitude, you just had to get on with it. Throughout her later years, she ended up at Abbeyfield Home, just around the corner, which was never meant to be a long-term plan for us. In fact, maximum 6 weeks, maybe even 6 days. Typically, in Molly's way, she defied all the odds and lasted another 5 years. Mum, at this stage of life, taught me a great deal of things, and one of them was acceptance. Acceptance where you are in life and what life throws at you. And she did that with so much grace, with that still twinkle in her eye. We will all miss her. And actually, it's hard to imagine life without Mum. Abby Fields. You've learned her, she had her first family in India, and her second family is all of us here. Her third family became Abbey Fields. And I can't tell you the care that they gave our mother. And they put up with all of us, constantly visiting, day and night. You know, 7 days a week. We were a family that just didn't leave our mother alone. Children, grandchildren, dogs, everybody came. And they didn't just look after our mum. They loved our mum. And when I said to one of them, thank you so much for looking after Mum, they said, it's really easy to look after your mum. She's easy to love. And it was true. That's what Mum did. Wherever she went, she was making new friends. Abbey Field were also very, very good, and they got used to Mum's sense of humour. And there was one story, well, there's a couple, actually, I must share with you. But there was a story when Mum decided she wasn't quite happy with the food at Abbey Field because she wanted always spicier food. So she grabbed hold of Paula. I hope Paula doesn't mind me mentioning this, but she renamed her, and she renamed her Chow Mein. And she'd sit in her room and she'd say, Chow Mein? Can I have a chicken Chow Mein? And it was just Mum's way of saying, I want some different food. And Paula, bless her, used to go off and get her a chicken chow mein whenever she wanted it. And I said to Paula, do you mind my mum calling you chow mein? And she said, Trish, I absolutely love it. It's not a problem at all. And then we had Courtney. Courtney started looking after Mum from the age of 17. And she really took care of Mum. And Courtney got renamed, as Mum named everybody and renamed everybody. And she called her Lashes, because she used to always wear false eyelashes. And when she started at 17, she really, really took care of Mum. And she's now running Abbey Field at the age of 23, which I think is amazing. And we're very, very thankful to everybody at Abbey Field of the care and love that you gave our Mum. Thank you all for turning up today. I know my Mum, our Mum, would have been absolutely overjoyed to be in her special place, this church, and what it gave to her. She was unique. I can honestly say she did not get old till she was 93. She was young in heart and soul, and she loved her family so much, all of them, all the tiny little ones, the middle ones, and the older ones. And it was a privilege that she was our Mum. Rest in peace, Mama.
We're going to hear from the grandchildren and great-grandchildren.
For our wonderful great Nana.
Of all the special gifts in life, however great or small, to have you as our Nana was the greatest gift of all.
May the winds of love blow softly and whisper in your ear, we love and miss you, Nana, and wish that you were here.
Deep in our hearts, your life is kept to love and cherish. No more tomorrows we can share, but the yesterdays are always there.
That was a bit of a hard act to follow, but... Ed and I have been given the difficult task of summarising Nana's, all of the grandchildren's memories into, a few minutes, which is pretty difficult. I want to start off by kind of diverging. Nana had nicknames for all of our grandchildren. You know, some of them made sense. Hat Pat, Georgie Porgy, Sebby Webby, and Theo's was Raja. I don't know why. I drew the short straw with Louis Pooey. But, you know, it was one of the ways that Nana used to interact with us. And, you know, it was really a testament to how loving she was as a grandmother to us all. I'll never forget Nana's kind of infectious smile. You know, whatever situation that I found her in, or I used to come home after school, she used to just be sat there on the sofa with a wry grin, some peanut butter brittle, and she'd go, "My son, make me a cup of tea." It's an awful accent. But yeah, she was the most loving grandmother that I could ever wish for. She was a big part of all of our lives. She, you know, was very, very resilient throughout the course of her own life. And I think, you know, she had an amazing family and loved us all as much as we loved her. She had an amazing ability to connect with people. So she always managed to connect with anybody at any level, whether it was a short kind of, you know, interaction, or whether it was a long-standing friendship. She always made everybody feel very warm in her own household. On a personal note, one of the memories that I have was that I actually lived with my Nana for a few years. I'm not sure everybody knows. So I had a very kind of personal relationship with her, and, you know, have many memories. But it was when I was about 14 or 15, which, as you can imagine, as a young man, you start to, you know, go to house parties and whatever, find beer and girls and whatever. But after every single house party, me and my friends used to go back to Nana's house, and she'd be sat there, sat up, with no teeth in. And then 3 15-year-old boys would come back and debrief her about, you know, whatever happened at the night out. Pre-night out story. On a Thursday, I used to come back after school, and because she lived around the corner to us, we lived on Acre Lane, and we used to share a cheeky Baileys and ice together, and we used to watch Western movies and Hallmark films, which was like one of the fondest memories I have. You know, Magnificent Seven, The Great Escape, just all of it. In her latter years, if you touch upon, you know, she was in Abbeyfield, and they've been absolutely wonderful with her. But as a fashionista, you know, I took great pride in trying to match my own loafers with my grandmother's, which, you know, we always managed to do. But, yeah, I mean, that's it for me.
So, Nana had lots of names for us, but she had lots of names as well. And in the generation, she was always a Nana for the grandchildren, but the great-grandchildren also gave her names. And what name did you give her, Leo?
Nana Popcorn.
Nana Popcorn. Because the thing when you went to anywhere where Nana was that there was always something that was offered to you. It could have been tea, it could have been gin, could have been vodka for certain visitors that came, pear drops, whatever it was, but nobody left Nana's house without eating or drinking or something deposited in their pocket on the way out, be it money or something for a grandchild. She was, as has already been said lots of times today, a wonderfully caring and giving human being. And as someone that's been lucky enough to have her in my life for my entire life, or 41 years of it, she is absolutely a role model of somebody that has loved and cared for their family. We all had a wonderful time sharing on WhatsApp, being obviously that generation, all the wonderful things that we remember about Nana. And a number of the stories, hilarious as they are, we're not going to share today. Because they are too wonderfully hilarious, but maybe not appropriate to say. But let's just suggest they're on a similar ilk of Bill talking about running down a hill, grabbing all the lampposts, but in lots of different locations around the world and around Bramall as well, actually. Pam touched upon the home and the family home. and Nana and Pop and Keith's family home. And our memory is mostly the grandchildren was at Ashley Drive. But Ashley Drive absolutely was a location where anybody could visit, could arrive and could turn up at any stage or at any point because the door was always open. The day that it was locked, you were concerned and you'd make a phone call to find out what had happened. But the really core memory that a number of all of us have is Sundays at Nana's house. Sunday dinner, Sunday lunch. Sometimes it'd be a curry, but you had to graduate as a grandchild before you were ready to have curry. You phrased from Sunday dinner or pizza, maybe you had a bit of dal or rice, and when you were ready, you then got Nana's curry. If you were quick enough to get any of Nana's curry, because if had enough had been made, you only got the extracts. We had no chicken left within it. But Nana's Sunday dinners were famous. It became that community hub of us on a Sunday that everyone would come together. The cousins would get to see each other, we'd play, we'd have fantastic fun, we'd build dens, we'd play, we'd make silly videos about Pop and whatever it may be. But the memories of the Britishness of partly of things like Sara Lee cake or certain ice creams would always be a bowl of pear drops that would be there for us as well. Now, there were some trips that happened. I think Bill mentioned, Marbella or Malaga from all the... there was also a trip to Tenerife, which I think there was some of Nana's showcasing skills. At this point, I think she'd injured herself and she was in a wheelchair. Had she broken her hip or had she kind of... But that didn't stop Nana demanding that she got to the dance floor. She drank a Jägermeister, because that's what you do at the age of 60, 70 odd, whatever she was, and then proceeded to demand that Joe pushed her around the dance floor with two great-grandchildren on her lap, dancing the afternoon and evening away. Nana was also a fantastic storyteller. And as in her house, or anybody she met, she would regale people with the stories of her life. Now, some of these stories may have had an element of truth. Some of them we may suggest that surprisingly, they changed every time they were told. But it didn't really matter, because there was joy, there was history, and there was love within those stories. And that was the wonderful thing about her. So, the other thing that she really loved was children and babies. And she was very lucky, as you can see, to have quite a lot of babies in her life, be it her own, or then her grandchildren, and then another six great-grandchildren. And I don't think there's a memory that will stick with me forever, which was Nana sat on her sofa or anywhere with a child, with a grandchild or a great-grandchild in her arm with a smiling face. And I think that will be a memory that I will hold there, because she would have sat there for 8 hours. At some point, I think she sat there for hours and hours. You try and remove this baby from her, and she'd give you a look that suggested, like, that's absolutely not happening. So I think we are all so blessed to have had her in our lives. And she will radiate the same way as she used to do in her dress and in the room for all our lives to continue. And I think she's a wonderful role model for all of us to take forward as we continue on to spread that love and family and community and continue to do that through our lives. So, here's to Nana.
Thank you so much, everyone, for sharing. I think we've all get a flavor of just the life that she lived. Let us stand and sing our final hymn together, Lord of All Hopefulness. Please just grab a seat, and I'm going to pray. But those words about just having just an open door and an open welcome, that is something that, as Christians, we believe that, in one sense, Molly's life is reflecting and radiating a God whose heart is open and a God whose arms are open. And that's what we believe for Molly. That's why we celebrate today. So let me just pray, just to kind of wrap up and round off all that we've heard about the life of Molly. Father, we want to thank you for Molly's life. Thank you for the gift of a life of love. Thank you for the gift that she was to so many of the family and friends that knew her. Thank you for just that radiation of love. And we know that actually in the Bible it says, we love because you first loved us. And thank you that actually the one who gave his life for us is the one who offers a quality of life with you that death cannot steal from us. And thank you that we can join Molly in coming home to that the only place where the hole in our hearts can be truly filled, which is with you. Comfort us where we weep, encourage us when we feel down, draw our hearts away from ourselves to you, so that when we arrive at death, we can hear and know that we have lived lives well lived because of you. Thank you for your love. Thank you that you embrace us as well. Embrace everyone here with your love, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to close with a song which I believe was dear for Molly, but is also a real song of celebration, which is Oh Happy Day. And I believe we will stand up and feel free to join in, feel free to clap. I believe Molly wasn't very stuck in the mud, so I don't think you have to. You have to feel you've got to put on your airs and graces, okay? If you want to boogie a little bit, you can.
Happy day.
If you'd like to join us for refreshments over the road, please do. Otherwise, have a great rest of your day. God bless.